So now I'm going to find the location of the resultant force. So in other words, YCP. So if you remember from the last lecture, we have said that YCP is lower than YC value here. So if this is the YC value, the YCP will be somewhere around here. YCP. So YCP is a distance. So you can see the Y coordinate here. It is from the Y coordinate to the location of the resultant force of the oil. Now the formula, if you remember the formula, so we will use this formula here. So let me go back to formula here. So we'll use this formula, but not in the form of this one, but we'll use in a more simplified way, which says that the YCP is YC plus the IX, XC, and that one divided by the YC into area. Okay, that is the simplified form of that one. If you look at our lectures, you can see how we have derived this formula. Let me do that here. So if I go back to the part here, so it will be YCP will be YC plus that IX, XC divided by that YC into area. And for this one, the YC distance we have found in the last lecture, so YC value is okay. This one is we have found in the last lecture. So it was that the 2 plus 0.3, which was 2.3 meters. This one was the YC distance. And for IXXC, this one is the square plate, which is 0.6 and the 0.6 dimensions. And we are taking the coordinate axis at the center of it. So this coordinate axis, which it is XC and the YC. When you take the second moment of area about that XC, you will have the 0.6 to the power of 4 divided by the 12. That one will be IXXC, and the YC value is 2.3, and the area value is 0.6 multiplied with the 0.6. If you do this calculation, you will find the location of the YCP. And with that one, we will finish it, so because we have found all of the values here. So if you have questions about this one, you can ask, or I will move on to next example. So you have all the values, you can find it. It seems that there's no any question, so therefore I'm moving on I will do one more example and then move on to conservation laws. So the example is, here we have a circular gate with a diameter of 8 meters in front of the water, which is 10 meters above the shaft of the gate. So here we have, this one is the circular gate. If you look at the cross-sectional view of this one, this gate is something like this one. Okay. The circular gate. This one will be YC and this one will be XC. And the diameter is 8 meters. So it has a diameter or radius of 4 meters. Let me add it to. This one has a radius of 4 meters. And there is a water which is 10 meters above the shaft of the gate. So you can see the value here. This one is a 10 meter. It is from the centroid of the gate. So from this distance. Okay, that C is the same one here. It is the same C. And there is a shaft here. So shaft means, if you have the shaft here, so water applies some pressure on it. So it means that this pressure and this shaft allows water to move from this part, because there is shaft here, it means that it can rotate. Okay, one direction, it can rotate in another direction. And find the resultant force due to pressure acting on the gate. We should find the resultant force. This is the first step. Location of the line of action of the resultant force, where it is located, and the moment applied to the shaft, because I've said it, this one is the hinge, and to that hinge you will apply, there will be some moment applied by the water. The question is that what is the moment applied on the shaft by the water. Now let's solve it. So firstly I will start from the resultant force Fr. You can do the integral form of FR, or you can do the simplified form of FR. You can work out with any. I will do here the simplified form, and the integral form will be homework. So integral form will be homework. But I will do the simplified form. It will be that rho g hc into the area. Okay, and the rho is clear, 10 to the power of 3, and the g is 9.81, and the hc is the distance from the free surface, from the free surface to the centroid of the body, which is given, which is 10 meters. Okay. And the multiplied with the area of it, which is pi d squared by 4. That is the area of the circular gate. And here, the diameter is 8 meters. Okay. So that will be the resultant force. So as I said in our lecture, that the FR resultant force, which is found by this formula here, it is the simplified form of, it is simplified form of PDA. It is a simplified form of the PDA, but if you want to do with the integral form, which is the PDA here, area, so you should use it as your homework, okay? So we have found FR. Now the question will be to find YCP. YCP, again, I will use YC plus IXXC divided by the YC into area. And for this question, you will need the, so you will need second moment of area of the circle, because the rest of the values are okay, because you can find YC, which is the 10 meters. But here you notice that instead of 10 meters, we'll use the angle version of the. So we will look for the angle, because it is not HC, it is YC, Y coordinate. And you can see that Y coordinate is inclined. So first let me write the, second moment of area of the circle, and then we can find the Y coordinate and as well as the YCP coordinate. The second moment of area for the circle is pi radius to the power of 4 divided by the 4. Write it. So it will be radius to the power of 4 divided by the 4. Or if you write this one as a diameter, it will be 64. Now comes the YC and the YC area. So area is clear. This one will be pi d squared by 4. Now YC distance. So as I said, the YC distance should be inclined version. So this one is the h. So YC will be something like this one. Okay. Use different color here. This one will be inclined version. Okay, because this is the Y coordinate. Okay, this one is Y coordinate. And this part is the X coordinate, which is the, again, inclined coordinate, but 190 degrees to the Y coordinate, to the X coordinate. So then I can create a triangle here. And I know that the angle over here is 60 degrees. It is given. Therefore, the angle over here is 30 degrees. And then this one is 90 degrees, and you have the triangle. And for the, this triangle, this is the point C. You can find that the YC will be equal to HC divided by the sine 30 degrees. Okay, this one is the YC distance. YC into sine 30 is the HC distance. Therefore, so from here you will get the 10 meters. So if you have, if you see any error in my trigonometry here, you can tell me. Otherwise, okay. So if you see any error, you can interrupt me at any stage. But now this one seems. So actually, this one is 60 degrees. Sorry, this one is 60 degrees. The angle is 60. Therefore, it will be 60 degrees. And therefore, you, if you divide this one by 60 degrees, okay, you will get the YC distance. So this one will be that 10 So this one is 10 divided by the sine 60. 10 divided by the sine 60. This one is YC distance. IXXC distance is there. Again, we will use the same YC distance, 60 degrees. And from here, you will get the YCP value for the gate here. So we can find the location of it, so it is clear now because we have all of the values and the diameter is 8 meters. If you can even simplify this one because you have the pi value here, you have pi here, you have the diameter here, therefore diameter to the power of 2 comes, and then you will have the 4 here and then 16. Okay, so this term goes. So then I found the YCP value. If you have the values, if you have done the calculations, you can tell me, but I will not do calculation part. I will just show the steps, how you are doing it. But because at the end, these are numbers. Just plug in numbers and you will find the value. But if you have found it, you can tell me the values. I can just write it. Okay, so I found the YCP distance. Now comes the last part, which is says that the find moment applied to the shaft that could open the gate. Okay, we will find the last part now. So we will have this one is C, and here you will have the CP. Okay, so due to that CP, you will have pressure. This one is the F resultant. F resultant will apply some pressure on this CP here. And that one, that CP will act from some distance of the C. So if I take you can take moments about any point. So I can take moment about, for example, the point C. Okay, if you take the moment about point C, it will be equal to zero if it is in equilibrium. Okay. That water moment about the point C, so we will have the weight of the gate about point C, so the weight of gate. So it will not create any moment since you have taken the point C, geometric center of it. So its moment is zero because the weight acts at the centroid of the body. Since you have taken this one is centroid. Moment about the centroid of the body, you will not have any force. Now comes the force due to resultant force. That will be Fr multiplied with the arm from C to CP. That will be the YCP minus YC. YCP value is here, and YC value is 10 by 760. And you should be very careful between HC and the YC values. And that one should be equal to the moment. We can say that the water tries to open gate in that direction. And I should apply some extra moment to prevent it. That is moment, let's say, that due to reaction force, MR. Okay. So if you find this value, and that will be the moment applied by the water to open the gate. Okay. But if you have some structure that allows to prevent that opening, that structure should have this amount of resultant force. So with this one, I have finished this question too. And if you have questions, if you have problems about this one, you can ask. Otherwise, I will move on to new lecture. So if you have questions, you can ask. But I will wait for some time for your questions. But if you don't have any question, I will move on to new lecture. So for new lecture, we will talk about the conservation laws. So for conservation laws, we'll have the conservation of momentum, conservation of energy. So let me open the conservation laws lecture. Okay, for the conservation laws, we will have the three types of the conservation laws. First one is the conservation of the mass. This one is the first step for the conservation laws. The second one is the conservation of linear momentum. And then you will have the conservation of angular momentum and then conservation of energy. So all of these conservation laws, if you remember, so it is very similar to, we have talked about the map of Azerbaijan. This one was the first example, or we have talked about the bank account. So you have fixed amount of property. It can be mass, or it can be that linear momentum, it can be angular momentum, it can be conservation of energy. And you have the fixed amount of it, and it doesn't increase or decrease. But if there are any change for the linear momentum or the angular momentum, then it means that there are additional effects that are acting on our system. Okay, firstly, so we have this generic equation. This is the Reynolds transfer theorem. So we'll not talk about this generic equation, but I'm just giving an information for you that all of the conservation laws are derived by using this equation here. All of the conservation laws are derived by using this equation here. But I'm not going to talk about the detailed derivation, but I will just write the final simplified form. Okay, that simplified form of conservation laws. Forms of conservation laws. I will just write the simplified forms of conservation laws. When I say that simplified form, it means that it is steady, okay? The system is steady and the properties are uniform. Okay. What it means to be steady? Steady means that there is no change with respect to time. With respect to time. So, this is the steady, and the uniform properties means that. So let me give you one example for the uniform properties. Say that this is the pipeline here. You have the pipeline, and inside that pipeline, the water moves. Say that this one is the water, and this one is the pipeline. Uniform means that you have the fixed amount of velocities at each section of the pipeline. You can see that the properties are uniform. For example, the velocity, these are the velocity vectors. So velocity vector at position one, this is position one, velocity vector at position two, velocity vector at position three, all of them are the same. V1 is same as V2 and the same as V3. At any location of the pipeline, you have the same velocity. That means that it is uniform, okay? And the steady means that it doesn't change with respect to time. Say that this is at time T0, and I look at the velocity vectors at next time here, for example. So for the same pipelines, I will have the, you see, the, this is the velocity one, this is velocity, let's say two, and this is velocity, this one is, come longer. So this one is velocity three. You can see at next time, at the same pipeline, okay, this is the pipeline at time T0, you have the velocity vectors. At time T2, you have the same velocity vectors. It doesn't change with respect to time, therefore it is steady, okay? No change with respect to time, and it is steady. One more example I can give you is that, say that you have a tank here with some outlet. So the density of the tank, so rho tank is, let's say, 1 kilogram per meter cube. This is at time is T0. And I'm looking for the next time. At the next time, I'm looking for the density of the tank here. Same tank. There can be a small change in geometry, but it is the same tank. So at time T1, where you have the next time, time is T1, you will have, again, the same density, which is 1 kilogram per meters. Good. That is steady, okay? There is no change with respect to time. The density is same, okay, at each point. So this is the steady. But what I mean uniform is that the location, there is no change with respect to location. For example, density here is 1 kilogram per meter cube. I take another location, it is 1 kilogram per meter cube. It is 1 kilogram per meter cube. It is 1 kilogram per meter cube. At any location, you have one. Density. Similarly here, if I move on to next time, you will have the one here, you will have the one here. This is the famous approximation that we are going to use. The first one will be that it is steady. There is no change in properties with respect to time. Uniform means that, in simple terms, no change here with respect to location. This one is for uniform properties, and this one is for the steady properties. So with these approximations, these are our assumptions, the famous assumptions. I will write it here, the approximations. These are the approximations that we always have, and we will not deal with the differential equations. We will always look for these final relations. And as I said, it is simplified. Okay? Because in real life, so it is not always steady, because in time you have change, and it is not always uniform. You will have the decrease or increase in properties. But for fluid mechanics, we can take this simple approach so that the properties are steady and no change with respect to time, or uniform, no change with respect to location. With these approximations, I will first write the conservation of mass. For the conservation of mass, the density, the velocity, and the area. The three properties, so let me write, instead of U, I can write the V here. Density, velocity, and the area is constant. This is for the conservation of the mass. Rho is density, V is velocity, and the A here is cross-sectional area. For conservation of mass, these three properties, the combination of these three properties are constant. If you multiply the density, volume, and area, you will get the same constant property at any location. Let me give you one example so that you can understand what's going on here. So this is pipeline. You have decrease in pipeline diameter. You can see it here. This one is a diameter D1 here. Let's say that it is 1 meter. This is diameter D2 here. It is 0.5 meters. And into that pipeline, you have the velocity at 1, which is at 0.3 meters per second. And it is required to find the velocity at point 2, velocity 2. This is a simple example to give you understanding what conservation law means for conservation of mass. To find the velocity at 2, so you see that I will use the conservation of mass, because it's all about the kinematic properties, and it includes the kinematic property velocity here. So let me do that. So firstly, I will write the conservation of mass, which says that rho VA is constant. Rho VA at point 1 will be equal to rho VA at point 2. Okay. And I know that the density of the water is 1,000 kilograms per meter. And since the density of water is constant, it doesn't change, I can cancel out this term. So VA1 becomes same as VA2. This is from the high school, you know it. And the area 1 is that pi d 1 squared by 4. Area 2 is pi d 2 squared by 4. And the velocity 2 is unknown, velocity 1 is 0.3 meters, and the pi cancels out, 4 cancels out, diameter 1, I can write this one as 1, therefore no problem with this part. And this one is 1.2, it will be 4, so 1/4, and therefore you can find the velocity at 2 will be equal to 1.2 meters per second. You see, this is a simple application of the conservation of mass. By the way, we have time limit on Zoom, so after some time, I think 5 minutes, so that we will get disconnected. Okay, so this is for the conservation of the mass. Now I will write the conservation of the linear momentum here. So, but before writing it, so I will just give the names for it. So rho VA combination, rho velocity area. This is called the mass flow rate, m dot. And the velocity and the area, it is called v dot. Okay, this one is the mass flow rate. And the second one where you have the v dot, it is called the volume flow rate. So what it is in volume flow, you can see that there is a rate quantity here, because when you have the dot over dot here, it means that the m by t. And when you have the volume over dot, it means that the v by t. Okay, and the, if you look for the units of it, for example, let's look at the unit of the rho VA here. So for unit of rho VA, first one has a unit of kilograms per meter cube. The second one has a unit of meters per second. And the third one has a unit of meter squared. Okay, you can see the units. First one is kilograms per meter cube, and the meter per second and meters squared. So you can cancel out these two terms here. At the end, you will get kilograms per second. Okay. And therefore, this one is m by t or m dot. This is for the conservation of the mass. Now comes the conservation of the linear momentum here. So I will talk about conservation of linear momentum. The second one. For the conservation of linear momentum, if you know the Newton's second law, it says that the net forces acting on the system, it is, you see, it is vector quantity. So that net, actually I can erase this summation here. Net forces acting on the particle, that will be equal to change of momentum. This is the Newton's second law, the change of momentum. Okay, but instead of the change of, instead of momentum, I can write it as components, which is mv. Okay, and if you assume that, if you assume m is constant, it doesn't change, then you will have that m dv by dt. You will have this quantity and it becomes ma. This is for the particle. And it is, you can say it is for the solid mechanics. But when we say that fluid mechanics, instead of talking about the particles, we are talking about the series of particles, because in fluid mechanics, you don't have one particle, you have the series of particles, lots of particles. And therefore, the conservation of momentum changes its behavior. And instead of talking about the rate of change of velocity here, which is acceleration, we are talking about the change of mass flow, mass here, which is m dot. So in fluid mechanics, it becomes that F net on the system, or CV, I can say a control volume, will be equal to M dot V. So this one out, that leaves the system, and it will be that M dot V in, just that enters to the system. Okay, you can see here, it is the MA, or if you simplify it, if you simplify, it will be that M V2 minus V1 divided by the delta T. You can simplify it. The acceleration is change in velocity divided by delta T. If I simplify the right-hand side here, it means that the, so if the velocities are same, if V in same as V out, then you will have that V M dot 2 minus M2 minus M1 instead of M dot, should be M2 minus M1 divided by delta T. You can see it here. So these are similar, but here, instead of talking about the, so it is not actually M dot, it is M. So in fluid, in solid mechanics, we are saying that mass into the change in velocity divided by the time. In fluid mechanics here, you can see it, we have assumed that the mass is constant. Here I also assume that the V in is same as velocity out, so velocity is constant here. Okay. M2 minus M1 divided by the delta T. You can see the similarity, they are very similar to each other. But I will not derive it because it is mathematical derivation here also. So actually these are vector quantities here. These are vector quantities. So you can see the similarity with this one and with that one. Now I'm going to use the conservation of momentum for fluid mechanics problems. But you should notice that here, when we say particle, fluid, solid mechanics, you are talking about a particle. But when we say fluid mechanics, we will take a control volume or a large amount of the system. So let me start with one simple example here. The example statement is, we have a water jet with given values here. It strikes to the plate in normal direction. Okay, this is the water jet. It strikes to the plate in normal direction. find force required to keep plate in place, neglecting gravity and the friction between water and the plate, show your control volume. So we don't consider the gravity, we don't consider the friction. These are neglected here. In other words, it means it is ideal. We will only consider and the show your control volume. This is very important for fluid mechanics. You have to show the control volume. See, control volume is important in solid mechanics, particle, but in fluid mechanics, control volume. So I will stop the recording here. Because we are at the end of the time. So I will start new link and new recording.